Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. Alhamdulillahi fatiris samawati wal ard. Ja'ilil malaikati rusulan uli ajnihatin. Masna wa sulasa wa ruba' yazidu fi khalqi ma yasha'. Innallaha ala kulli syai'in qadir. Alhamdulillahilladzi arsala rasulahu bil bayyinati wa anzala ma'ahumul kitaba wal mizan liyakuma an-nasu bil qist wa anzala al-hadid fihi ba'sun shadid wa manafi'un lin-nas wa liya'lama Allahu man yansuruhu wa rusulahu bil ghaibi innallaha qawiyyun aziz. Dear Brother Ihsan, as moderator, the chairperson of this majlis, my dear brother Dr. Farouk, old friend, a colleague, a student. One time I'm his student, at the other time he's my student. My oldest guru, never my murid, is Brother Azzam Tamimi. We were having this Tamimi airline. Tamimi airline consists of when by the color of yellow. We had a good summer camp. The first summer camp supposed to be held in Dewsbury, Manchester, in 1977, supposed to be Arabic class. Then we protested because we are not going to be ulama to master Bahasa Arab. So we want to be activists. We want to know more about tafsir. And you know, Brother Azam Tami was good in Arabic, good in Bahasa, good in English, and not good in tafsir at the time. So we asked him to give tafsir, simple about tafsir. You read the Arabic, then you translate into English, then we will understand. And later on, very in a short time, Brother Nader, Brother Azam become a very good tafsir, musafir and mufasir and musafir as well. So then after when we converted the Arabic class from Arabic into summer camp, we had a very long topic. The official tafsir was only for morning or afternoon session, but we have illegal session at night. Brother Azam was very committed in giving the tafsir for as good as 10 o'clock to 11:30. So we are very rich in tafsir. So at the end of this tafsir session, we concluded after reading Surah Furqan, Surah An-Nisa, that the sisters, it's haram for you to study in England without a mahram. Azam Tami was the real person who incited our sisters to get married with our brothers. So that's why my wife, she was only A-level first year, I was A-level second year. We got married before my A-level result came out. Thank you, Brother Adam. So that was very interesting. He's a real motivator, real fighter, real persuader, real culprit to the Malaysian government. He's about as many Malaysian sisters and brothers getting married before they go to the higher level of education. So Brother Nader, thank you. No more police harassment for you. And Dr. Azhar, my good friend, always enjoy his lecture, always have a new dimension. And dear brothers and sisters, the participants of this program, thank you for coming to this program. That is the first summer class. Yeah? These are not the students, not all the students. So I hope you all enjoy your session. We had this station summer camp in England back in 1977, the first one. So then they had some summer camp in Malaysia by the motivators known as Asan Ali, by successful, but a lot of business or background to it. So when we talk about summer camp, we having knowledge of tafsir, hadith, sirah, and your particular module, I see, is very important in the sense that it contains a lot of thinking about tajdid, mujaddid. That was the whole idea that we want to know about our religion and our life in this world. or change. So today I'm invited or requested or asked by Dr. Farouk to give a keynote address, which was too high in the expectation. By the way, I will try to approach it from my perspective. I see that the topic is difficult. The topic talk about the need for reform for the future of Malaysia and Muslim Ummah. So there's the question of whether I will identify as need is exact need or is only my want. Am I talking about need, which is more urgent than the want? There is more wish of us when we see about change and Islamic movement, the failure of its political party, Islamic political party in this country, the low expectation of the low hope of population, Malaysian population, towards a new political party. Recently, they have a survey by Ilham Group, a survey group, to say that the first political party was given a low, the highest but still low, confidence of the rakyat as regard to be the guardian of the Malay politics and political interest. But the younger one, the one that is established after the separation between the break between the leaders in the same political party into formation of the second political party, but we call ourselves Parti Amanah. We call ourselves the party that would like to bring about change in the sense that it is progressive, it is concerned about the affairs of the rakyat, of the poor people, of the society, as well as when we talk about inclusivity, it is a party that talk about bringing rahmah, rahmatul lil alamin. So we are not certain where are we heading this country, because what we perceive as our need for change, need for a new political party, need of old dogma and old khurafat to be dismantled. The biggest khurafat in this country is that there's only in political process in the democracy one political party. This has been sung long time ago by the leaders, by the asatizah, by the people who claim to be ustaz, ulama, that it is big haram to form another Islamic party. It's going to divide the Ummah, it's going to divide the Malays, it's going to weaken the political power of the Malay and the Muslim when there's a second political party. But we know that not far from us, the Indonesian politics, there are seven political party. They can debate, they can write books, they can have polemics, they can heated the discussion and debate, but they enrich the political democratic process of Indonesia. So now when we talk about need for the reform, I hope when I outline later on in the last 30 minutes of my presentation, that can be debated, can be discussed clearly within ourselves, need, the meaning of the need. I consider myself to defining only one need, one agenda, one need, one focus, and one platform. I'll go to that later on. Then the issue of reform. We have got to define. Perhaps we have different stages. When we talk about Saudi, if there's any democracy, there's no democracy. If there is a democracy in Kuwait, in Arab countries, in Indonesia, in where in Cambodia, for example, is non-Muslim country, but there are some cultures that are close to Muslim. For example, you go to their bathroom, their washroom, their toilet, they have water supply, meaning they clean their after they eat themselves using water. That's a close way. Meaning to say, they're Buddhist, a bit different from Rohingya Buddhist, but they can tolerate in the city of Phnom Penh. There are many masjid, big azan, strong azan. There are in Phnom Penh, there are 436 masjid. In remote area, in far distant area, where we travel, we took 6 hours, there's masjid. Christian country, Buddhist country, which can accommodate Islam and Muslim. So we can see that the agenda is different. Reform there may be different from in Malaysia. So I face a difficulty tonight to try to give the meaning of reform, the agenda of reform, the details of reform, the activities and the initiative for reform within the different dimension of political scenario and political platform. Then future of Malaysia and Muslim Ummah. I see there's a real reason why the organizer want us to discuss the future of Malaysia and the future of Muslim. I would like to see that the issue of Ummah is being opened up, not to be inclusively, exclusively belonging to the Muslim. I would like to see the future as Ummah belongs to the political aspiration of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when he established a political compact, political agreement, tahaluf siyasi with various people, the Muslim, the non-Muslim, the Aus, the Khazraj, the Mushrik, the Muhajirin, the Ansar, the Jews, the Christian, the some individuals of the Christian community, and they say there's some Chinese. We have time, we got to study it. During the ascent of Saifah Madinah, there's some Chinese community in Madinah. This is interesting, if it's true, then we can see the relevance of the Silk Road, Jalan Sutra, to the political hegemony of the Eastern people of China, the meaning of learn knowledge, get the knowledge, even you go to Sin. And the finding in one book that the Sahaba have traveled even to Pulau Tioman. Pulau Tioman, Tioman, they written there as Toman, T-O-M-A-N, in Latin word. Meaning to say that world 1,400 years ago is the same world that we are. There's superpower, there are hegemony of power within the whatsoever society that have dominance in the world. So these are the background. Then of course, well, there's my picture. Okay, the title is the need for reform for the future of Malaysia and the Ummah. Okay, what is reform? Reform, reformation, and revolution. All topic. During my time and Brother Azam time, we taught this matter for so long. What is reform? What is revolution? What is tajadud? What is tajadud? We have discussed Maududi's concept of tajadud, which is reformasi or reformation. We talk about Maududi's concept of tajadid, which means revolution. Revolution is something is close to the process how Rasulullah SAW established a Muslim state in Madinah. All those topics will not go still relevant today. Which when you talk reformation, we talk about reform, gradual change. Revolution mean radical change. So to Muslim, we have our own meaning to reform. We talk about tajdid, islah, taghir, sawra. These are all the terms that some of you may have come across. Some of you may not come across. Some of you may have forgotten. But tajdid is relevant. We talk about tajdid. Tajdid may mean renewal, awakening or revival. It always mean in some Arab countries they prefer sahwa, al-Islamiyah. The Islamic awakening refers to revival Islam and way of life. Okay, tajdid is important within Islamic tradition. Tajdid has been an important religious concept which has manifested itself throughout Islamic history in periodic calls for renewed commitment to the fundamental principles of Islam and the construction of society and in accordance with Quran and Sunnah. So the meaning of tajdid is more comprehensive. People like tajdid. I love tajdid. When I first come across to the idea of tajdid written by Maududi in his book the brief history of Islamic Republicist movement, that was great relief to my heart. I read the book, like it so much, and I rewriting the book in different form. End up me writing 7-9 series of books for tarbiyah by the name of Abu Orwa, written in Bahasa Melayu, Bahasa Malaysia. End up to complete in nine volumes. So because of that effort, Professor Kamal Hassan, the previous director of IIM, in his paper talking about the influence of Maududi, the influence of Hassan Bana, the influence of Jamaat Islami and Ikhwan in Malaysia, he recognized me, he put me as a person who first bring about the thought and writing of Maududi in Bahasa Melayu in Malaysia. I was in detention of IIC during that time. He said the person who first bring about the realization about Islamic literature or Maududi writing in Bahasa Malaysia in Malay to Malaysia was a person by the name Abu Orwa or Saari Sungib, the former president of GYM, who now in detention of IIC. That was a big relief as a recognition that I was considered as one of the little writers who have written to bring awareness of Malaysian towards the thinking of Syed Abdul Al Maududi. Alhamdulillah. So now, when we talk tajdid, tajdid is something that is more organized. When we talk about tajdid, it's more comprehensive. When we talk about tajdid, we believe the tajdid, as will be many issues will be raised in your training in summer camp. What the mujadid? Normally they start from early, from the earliest. They say Jamaluddin Al-Afghani, they say Muhammad Abdul, Muhammad Rashid Radha, and they go backward from there. They go to talk about Syekh Waliullah Dahlawi, Syekh Masirindi, Mujaddid Al-Fithani, all this Indian continent Mujaddid. You can imagine we have Mujaddid Al-Fithani, the Mujaddid of second millennium. We discuss. Then earlier on, they go to even 5th century Islam. That Al-Ghazali, Tamimi, later on, and name big names like that. Then they work back again to even mention Abu Hanifa, Imam Malik, Imam Ahmad, Imam Syafi'i as Mujaddid. So this is beautiful when we see that Mujaddid, the meaning of Mujaddid, are the people who have contributed and being mentioned in the hadith reported by Hakim. That the reason for Mujaddid to be raised at the end, at the beginning of every new century, is to man yujaddidu amrin lina, to renew, not to renew the religion, but to renew the amrun, urusan, hal ehwal, dina, urusan agama kamu. So there's a very specific meaning to tajdid. Tajdid is not to about renewal of the religion, because religion is complete. The Prophet, the Anbiya, since the Mino, until Muhammad, a series of work they have done. As such, in the true meaning of Islam, there's no revolution. Because no matter how big a mujahid is, he only revived the teaching of the Prophet, close in entitled in the Quran, or even the earlier Mujaddid, without bringing new syariat or new meaning, but interpretation. This is what I will emphasize very deeply today, how we should think that the work of tajdid is more in terms of how we perceive the maqasid objective Islam. We object, we perceive the meaning of Al-Quran. Does Al-Quran, the text within the context, is so important in terms of methodology? Oh, we understand Al-Quran is giving us what are the sawabit, what are the principle, and what are the mutaghayyirat. This is now the current thing. When you talk about mutaghayyirat, things are changing. Is prayer changing? People say, no, pray, but they don't change. I may say, I can say, maybe wrong, but I say prayer even can change. How? We can discuss. My teacher is listening closely to me. So I want to say that even hudud, the practice of sudo, the fine things of hudud is maybe something that is, there are some substance, there are some component which are mutaghayyirat. For example, the issue of unending the polemic of ulama between, when we talk about hudud, hudud mean the punishment, the crime that is specified in the Quran or in the text of hadith, and the amount of punishment, the type of punishment is specified. So when you go to zina, for example, many people say zina is hudud crime, because it's specified in the Quran, 100 lashes for those who committed zina among the rare muhsan. While committing the zina, he was or she was not in the state of having a partner, legal partner. But for those who muhsan, fortified, they are protected because they have partner, their wife, their husband, yet committed zina, their hudud was rejam. Argument say rejam is found in the Quran. Early on, there was the verse in the Quran to say that zina is present in the Quran as hudud. But later on, that idea is very weak, not accepted. Then they say hadis. The only punishment prescribed in the Quran, not in the Quran, there is in the hadith, that is related to hudud is rejam. Then later on I find out that Yusuf Sokhadabi quite lately said that even that hadith is weak. Now he was proposing that in the punishment of hudud for zina, is ta'zir. The punishment for muhsan doing the zina is ta'zir. Meaning to say that zina in principle is crime perceived as hudud, but for particular person that happened in the siasa syariah of the Ummah, for example, they have four wives, he is fortified by committing zina, but yet committing zina, he was prescribed as hudud of 100 lashes plus later on ta'zir by rejam. So these are the things that I've studied, I've learned. I think that if things like that the hukum of hudud also can change, the whole idea of hudud as something that is compulsory will be can also change. So I got some discussion with some Sudanese brother. He passed away. But he said, "Brother Abu, I believe one law in the Sharia that is being abolished. If I tell this, the sister will be happy. Brother won't be happy." He said, "I think like slavery, which is being abolished, I believe polygamy also has been abolished." Tak ada orang suka, perempuan tak suka. So itu satu benda, that's one thing that I'm thinking about. When we talk about mutaghayyirat, not only the particular aspect of thing that is you have nas, but you must be seen in the bigger context. I'm still looking, I'm learning, studying how big books like Kitabul Kharaj, your Mardudi book, Mawardi books on Ahkam Sultaniyah, which Brother Azzam advised us not to read, is also books that is not giving emphasis on things that is said as Sharia in the context of hudud. So now we are looking at this system. Tajdid is something fundamental in this approach. So again, concept of tajdid played a prominent role in the contemporary Islamic revival. Another islah. So islah mean in uridu ilal islah mastata wa matawfiki ila billah alaihi tawakkaltu wa ilaihi unib. Then dia ada surah in surah wala tufsidu fil ardi ba'da islahya. The word, the second ayat more giving a meaning of islah, something that is dynamic. Don't make fasad on the earth whose beauty, whose system islahya, being improved to better all the time. You go into any system of the ecology of the world, the rain system, wasama izatis sadar. Just like that, Allah mentioned in very brief ayat, describe the whole system of rain, snow, whatever, the cloud. Islahia is very dynamic. Very dynamic concept mean to always improve, to better, or to put something into a better position. Then the word al-islah occurs 40 times in the Quran, where it means to restore oneself or to reconcile people with one and to make peace. Like you can read in surah Al-Hujurat, wa yang ta'ifatan minal mu'minin nak tatalu fasilu bayinahuma. If two ta'ifah of the Muslim born in brought in fight, no, you got to islah one of them. This itself show to us that the dynamic of Muslim politics. At one time, people say that politics is part of this dunya, not the specific ilmu. Like when the Prophet said, "Antum khairu umat." Antum ma'alamu bi umuri dunyakum. You are more knowledgeable, you know more about umuri dunyakum, urusan dunia kamu. So one alim said, not only tanam pokok, pollinating the fruits of the dates is urusan dunia, but politik is urusan dunia. Anything to do with politik is urusan dunia. This is when I first read this remark. People claim under as bahawa the thinking of Syahli Abdul Razak. Syahli Abdul Razak believe that antum alamu bi umuri dunyakum is the whole area of politics. Whether you choose khalifah, you prescribe the war, the structure of the government, the governance, anything to do dengan politik is umuri dunyakum. It's nothing to do with religion. I hated this idea. When I was young, I tak suka, I don't like Syekh Ali bin Abdul Razak. But then I become older, now, I started to appreciate. I tend to appreciate him. Then I sympathy on him because he was blessed. He was slandered, he was not given justice in his book. When you talk about the demise, the abolition of Khilafat, the world Islamic Khalifah. So now I feel at peace when we talk about, let's just say, politics is an area that is open. Nothing sacred about politics. You want to go to the principle of justice, religion is part of the politics is part of religion, up to you. But I believe the free you are to interpret that there's a big area of mutaghayyirat in politics. There's very minimum concept of sawabit, fundamentals in the siasa, in the politics is better. Well, okay. So now I'm writing this point. The word islah, that's why politics islah ada. Jemaah islah pun ada. Pak Abim, apa ni, my friend persuaded me to form the Jemaah Islam Malaysia. I was end up to be the president for 9 years. Why I was asked by Anwar Ibrahim to help him in Parti Amanah. Parti Amanah, eh? Bukan Parti Keadilan. Okay, now issue dia begini. It is used most commonly today in Arabic with respect to the idea of reform. Although this usage was not widespread until modern reform movement of 1920. Okay, nanti kita akan pergi definition saya tentang my definition on reform relevant on 19th and 20th century. Why? It helps either because when we have Jemaah Islah Bali Rashad, where is Tunisia? Mahfuz Nahana. Brother, remember? Jemaah Islah Bali Rashad. In Tunisia, is in Algeria? Brother Mahfuz Nahana. Algeria. So the idea was the more you are open, the more you are democratic, the more you embrace politics as something that is not divine, not sacred, the less you claim that you are the Islamic party, the less you claim that people want to be salvation, you got to join the Islamic party, the better. Okay, Islah also means to make better. Tagir means to change, to prevent or to stop. From the verse of Al-Quran, the famous ayat on tagir, the famous hadith on tagir, man ra'a minkum munkaran falyughayyirhu biyadihi, to change. So I thought, when I read that is, I thought the idea of preventing it to stop, but tagir mean not only to stop but to change it from bad to something progressively better program. Okay, now being fast, Thawra always mean revolution, coming to power by fighting armed struggle, which is properly called jihad. Then back to reform. Okay, let's this we take from the Western concept. Western concept, our concept, we have defined Islam. Very wide ranging. We have defined what they did, which is a model of change. From there, lahirlah mujadid. But in this Western concept, the meaning is very cair. The meaning of reform is very mild, very very subtle, very not heavy. And we can agree with the meaning of reform that we would like to take for Malaysia. So reform means the improvement or amendment of what is wrong, correct or unsatisfactory. Amendment, just amendment. Then the use of word in this way emerges late 18th century, which identified with parliamentary reform. Meaning to say, the West had advanced. They have gone, we are advanced. We have our Sahih from Medina, 14 years ago. The West, they have Magna Carta. Magna Carta was the year 700. That is 700, 600 years after Saifa Madinah. And Magna Carta was only for the aristocrat, not for the rakyat. We have Rasulullah SAW organized Saifa Madinah for the common people. If it is true, the Chinese living in Madinah was a part of the people who have agreement for that. But Magna Carta is basis for people to keep the king in power, with power, and to keep the aristocrat limited to power within the framework of parliament. So parliament was relevant to the Western society, the British, the French, the German, of their own accord, because they respected this, the role of the king, the role of the barons, duchess, the aristocrat of the country, to be limited by power. But we have caliphate. We have Abbasiyah, we have Osmania, then we have Umayyah. All are despotic. Most of them are despotic. So we have the situation that they have the more experience in terms of organizing community with power, with king limited to hold certain power, and they are much better in literature. You can get the history of king of Holland, you can get the history can king of Portugal, Spain, before the and many other country, because they have a good record of king or queen that uphold the power of the parliament. So the best of which was the British so far. So that is what we will talk about. Why reform is being confined to an approach that is until now the best within the constraint of parliamentary process. So reform is generally distinguished from revolution. That is their way. Revolution means fundamental or radical change. Is it so? That is what they say. They practice. They believe in secularism. They define secularism according to their perception of how power should be regulated through parliamentary process. Not only now we feel that secularism is good to a certain level of society neutrality on religion. I will go on that later on. So now we are talking reform may be no more than fine tuning. Is there a concept? Reform is more than fine tuning. Yes. Or at most addressing serious wrongs without altering fundamentals of the system. That my vision is to have Malaysia a place where politicians have conscience. They do not support a motion, a stand, simply because he comes from one particular party. But because the debate says that this is right, this is wrong, he may have his own opinion, different from his party. And he may not be penalized for that. Not like what I did. And two of us decided that the rest of our colleague in the assembly of Sango do not reject the motion of the president, we were punished. I was suspended from the party, but I was punished with all nasty, nasty word, waiting for me to go out from the party. So you can see the difference here. So I would like to see Malaysia in this understanding of reform as policies-driven politics. We drive our policies, our manifesto. People accept us in our election campaign because our program is much better. Not because our Islam is much stronger. Not because we want to put hudud. Not because we are anti-liberal. Not because we are anti rethinking of thing that is they say that when we talk about this is mutaghayyirat, this is not, they will say this is liberal thinking. So this is the dangerous thing that I would like to emphasize, that what we are doing now, reform seeks to improve system as it stands, never to overthrow its wholesale. Radical is on the hand, seek to improve the system, but try to overthrow whether the government, group of people themselves. Wow. All right, so can reform be something revolutionary? This is important. Rotation in office or term will limit by contrast. Can be revolutionary. For example, when Parti Keadilan state that the president will only be given to be in a position for 2 terms, that is revolutionary. But technically, it's a very technical. But to us, very revolutionary. So I'm... okay, for example, radical. Developing countries may carry out wide range of reform to improve their living standard. This is revolutionary. You talk about changing the political philosophy, economic philosophy, economic program, going to microeconomy, civil service. It's not easy. When JP talk about reducing the number of civil servants, it becomes a big issue. We are the biggest bureaucracy in the world, 1.5 million people in this. So a lot of money gone to pay pension, allowances, and so on. Okay, now I'm moving to this idea. When they talk about reform within the Western society, they talk about religious reform in religions and churches. We call this secularism. We don't like this idea. But when we talk about democracy, about multi-racial, multi-religious, like Malaysia, there's no way, no other way than you for you to organize it through that way. Otherwise, people say, why the Malays, the Muslim have the advantage of zakat, money, well, they can't. It's very, very serious issue. But we never address this except with threat. Jangan masuk campur dalam urusan kami. Jangan masuk campur dalam urusan Islam. Zakat urusan kami. So there's no improvement in our political interaction. So to me, I would like to say that you should agree. Reform means improvement or amendment of what is wrong, corrupt or unsatisfactory. Use of this word is in relation to political process. Meaning to say, okay, let's say kita terima. So the topic is the need to perform reform for the future of Malaysia and Hudoma. What are then our platform of reform? I would like to see this into two separate entities. What I wish that when we talk Ummah, it's not exclusively for the Muslim. Ummah is a purpose. Ummah is for a maqasid, for a maksud. Maksudnya adalah untuk menubuhkan kesatuan di kalangan berbagai-bagai kaum, agama bangsa di Madinah. Rasulullah went to meet all this and write first written document of political compact. The word Ummah was used for the first time, relating the Muslim and Muslim, Ansar Muhajirin, the Jews, the Mushrik, as Ummah. The time when there are breach of agreement, and it's when the treason among the Jews towards the compact of Saifah Madinah, Rasulullah SAW rewrote it, deleting the word Ummah. So I would like to say that in Al-Quran, Umamun, the mention of Ummah, haiwan, burung-burung, is a political, it carry more political significance than any religious concept of working together. So I would like to see that when we talk about future of the Ummah, in the future, how the Ummah see the Chinese, the Buddhists, the Christian, the Hindus, whatever, can come together to see the common interest is to take care of this, the strength, the security, the dignity of this country. So for that, I will say, this is a bit heavy. I created this idea at 7 o'clock. Finally, I found out. I will say, what are our platform? For change, for reform to take place, there would be two platforms. One, the inclusive participation of all levels of rakyat in the democratic structure, process, space, as instituted within the revolutionary understanding of the constitutional framework and rule of law of our beloved nation. Meaning to say, our constitution is revolutionary. Constitution be state, the king, The Sultan rotates every 5 years to have one king. It's revolutionary. But people don't appreciate. We cannot, we do not interpret that from a revolutionary concept. We just interpret it as an administrative concept. Otherwise, prior to that, the king of the Malay state will fight each other, will sabotage, will get the Siamese to help them, to get the Sumatran Palembang to come, get the Dutch, get Portuguese to sabotage each other. Now it's become a major force. We have 11 king and raja, and work together. Sekali je bawa yang lepas jawatan, agung. That must be seen. Ini strength dia. Why? To me, as I answered in on our session itu, how can the Sultan and the King being changed their role from the guardian of the Islam? Islam at national level is taken care by Agong. Ini by Sultan. How? I say by the constitution of Malaysia, itself can safeguard. Can disqualify a king to be king and a sultan being a sultan. So when we talk, there's one angle. If you talk about prime minister, somewhere within, I can understand, as I understand it, the framework of our constitution was well thought of by various lawyers, ex-lawyers in Pakistan, India, England, that they want this country to be a secular country. Yeah. That's a long story, but I've made some studies on constitution. So I understand that it's one of the most vibrant, flexible constitution of the world is Malaysian constitution. Because within it, there are diversities, difficulties, a lot of compromises. Because you don't forget, Malaysia, Malaya, Tanah Melayu is the second source of income to the whole British Empire. You have, at that time, rubber, tin, and US currency exchange. Sterling pound is moving into American dollar because of the Second World War. So at that time, tin stockpile is being controlled by US dollar. So we are the second biggest contributor to the British Empire. The empire that the sun never set. That's the word, end. So how that happened, then they become the second power, but still maintain the first maritime power in the world until now. Okay, so I would like to insist on that. This model is quite important, and from that, how are you going to... Oh, salah angle, eh? Saya tunjukkan yang lain. Saya nak tunjukkan ini. Okay, ini. This is the thing I would like to say. Then from that, you have agenda. Ada agenda banyak. Kalau nak ambil nota, boleh ambil nota. You can take my notes from here. Based on this particular mission, okay, you have agenda. My point is simple. When you talk about agenda, you are talking about institutional reform is a process of reviewing and restructuring state institutions so that they respect human rights, preserve rule of law, and are accountable to their constituents. Ini itu ya yang kita nak kena bawa dalam masyarakat tentang peranan kita, our role when we talk about reform. But when we talk about agama Islam, difficult. It's not difficult. For we talk about nak ajak orang reform Malaysia, tak susah. Manifesto yang ada, Pakatan Harapan, Pakatan itu boleh buat. BN punya manifesto kalau dia setia boleh buat. Tapi dia tak nak buat. Tapi what the biggest difficulty is to carry out reform to the Muslim mind. And I'm thankful and grateful to Brother Dr. Farouk mengatakan the most suppressed religion or group of people are Muslim. In this country, the most suppressed kita. Program dia tak boleh buat kat Selangor. Boleh buat kat Selangor ni. Saya rakyat Selangor, ada Selangor cik hati. Dan saya kena bungkus. Tak boleh. Cakap Islam macam ni tak boleh. Saari Sungib takkan dapat tak boleh ucap kat masjid. Yang pas pantau, jadi tak bagi adun yang tak guna tu, adun khianat, wali kursi. Satu lagi, perkara-perkara agama tak bagi. So, we are the most surprised. So, okay, kita punya cabaran paling besar ni, how to revolutionize pemikiran ustaz-ustaz tu. So, our platform for reform, the sharp focus to work diligently and continuously like Dr. Farouk and myself and my group. Guided maqasid al-insaniyah. Okay, maqasid al-insaniyah kita jadikan through revolutionary process of unlearning and relearning. What are thawabit? What are mutaghirat? Fundamentally derived from the text, Al-Quran and Sunnah, within the diversifying context in order to always at zero, ground zero. What is the ground zero? That we are problem solvers. We are rahmat wal alam. Mana tu how small you buat, you give pencerahan, you give pertolongan, you give this is what we need to do. Saya mengatakan dalam nota kecil saya kata kat sini, saya mungkin salah, unlearning and relearning the text Al-Quran and Sunnah. Okay, maknanya dalam buku Muhammad Asad yang dikatakan Islam the crossroad, dia kata don't worry, as long as you know the direction of Islam, you know more or less what is now called as maqasid syariah, you have good intention, you approach the Quran as hidayah, you won't commit a big mistake of sesat. Okay, ini yang takut. Baca Quran macam Dr. Farouk ni, he's a Muslim scholar. No, as Muslim scholar, he's not ulama. You are not ulama. He's not ulama, tapi dia Muslim scholar. Jangan tu. Okay, jadi saya nak jelaskan kat sini, differentiating the tawabit dengan mutaghayirat adalah benda yang urgent bagi kita. Work within the new trajectory of present and future world. Give assertive energy and resources to embrace fully principle of hayat. As the core of Islam adalah hayat. Dan kalau kita tengok dalam kehidupan Rasulullah SAW, dia banyak deliberate on akhlak. Dia was very brief and simple on akidah. Hadis dalam Bukhari kata, bila Rasulullah tanya pada budak perempuan yang cuci harta Tuhan dia, kat mana Tuhan? Tengok kat langit. Tak betul, tapi Rasulullah tak handle. Benda tu tak risaulah. Okay, jadi oleh kerana itu saya ingin ucapkan terima kasih kepada tuan-tuan dan puan-puan. Saya panjang sikit. So, banyak seronok ni. Patut menteri yang buat ni kan? Menteri Pendidikan. Patut Menteri Pendidikan bagi ucapan ni. Tapi dah tak ada Menteri Pendidikan, Menteri Pendidikan sendiri buat. Jadi saya ucapkan terima kasih. Jazakallah khairan. Panjang penyampaian saya dan saya ucapkan terima kasih. We're open. I'm still masih lagi mencari dan masih belajar. Dan the thing that I learn from OS is about the system, learning, unlearning, relearning, learning, and making ourselves as the biggest learning culture, learning organisation, learning jemaah alumni parti, and learning family. Dan learning itu merupakan asas kita. Kita akan pegang pada satu konsep yang baik. If it works, it's obsolete. Anything that works, is obsolete. Meaning you got to look for new things. You got to unlearn what you learn, what you have. You got to unlearn, relearn, unlearn, relearn, unlearn. And you become understanding, punya kepahaman yang lebih baik. Dan dengan ucapan itu, saya ucapkan terima kasih. Wabillahi taufiq wal hidayah. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.